Well, here we go. A new week, a new day. Time to get this thing going. All right, we're getting the shop open up. Gonna fire up a day in the shop. Thanks for tuning in, I'm glad you're here. I'm Jimmy, you're making it work if you're new and you're not sure what's going on. This guy's doing these random things, flipping lights on, plugging in extension cords. It's part of the process. S10's still here, we're still working on that in perpetuity. Volkswagen's still here, we're working on that in perpetuity. We got a 68 GTO over there. But we got a beautiful sunshine, we got, the sun is out this morning. It's in the 40s, but it'll be 76 degrees later, apparently. So I'm wearing a shorts and a jacket, because that's how you do it in Florida. Because you know, the temperature can change as much as 30 degrees from morning till midday, so. Oh, project truck is still looking good back here. Probably hard to see in the sun glare, but let's put in some clips of what's gonna be in today's video. I got this coolant sensor, Warlock. All right, so you guys have a pretty good idea what's happening. I'm guessing the Volkswagen's gonna get tidied up a little bit. Probably gonna do a little bit of working on that S10, figure out what's going on with that thing with the battery dying. Obviously, whoever told me to look at the cluster because it's killing the battery and the needles were going up, we went down the wrong path. Let's go ahead and finish getting the shop open up. Do what we can to learn a thing or two. Maintain our calmness, our, what's that, feng shui? And try to make this into a better week than last week. We're definitely gonna have some fun either way, because I'll make fun of myself if I have to, just to get through the day and to make it, what's the word? Orable, or paddleable. Paddleable is the best. Let's finish getting this place open up, get started. Stay tuned. I'm gonna start off trying to button this Volkswagen up, and I got this coolant sensor unplugged. Uh-oh, that's not supposed to happen. It's supposed to look like this guy. If you guys remember, Friday, this was acting up, causing a code reading negative temperatures, like minus 38 or 28 or something like that. Plugged into one from the original engine, it worked. So now I gotta transfer it over, but only half of it came out. That's why there's no coolant coming out of that hole. So now I gotta try to get that piece out of there, I guess. Let's see if we can get it out here. But that's how everything's gone on this so far, so why it would make perfect sense if you think about it. I got the bolt in by hand a little bit. I got the piece out. I don't know where it went, but it's down there somewhere. I'm gonna try to fish it out if I can. Where could it have possibly gone? I felt a little pop and boink, and a little piece came out. It's just the bottom of the sensor, about that much, with a second O-ring on it. And that's why coolant spilled out. I'd really like to find that piece to show you what it looks like. This here is a Warlock by the Dodge Motor Company. 1977 or so, it looks like. I'm not sure. I didn't get paperwork yet. Do you remember that red Dodge, just 59 or so, that we had in here not long ago? 77, I think. 449, no, that's not right. Oh, well, we'll figure it out, don't worry. We'll figure it out. You used to be able to go by the 8th or 10th, I forget which one it was. Anyway, yeah, I'm old. That's how we used to look up the year. Didn't used to be stamped on it. I want to say it's about a 76, 77. Cool truck. A lot of paint on it. Laid it on pretty heavy. That's how you know what it is. The Warlock with a 318 two barrel. Ooh, hang on. It's actually a pretty nice truck. Way nicer than his red car so far. I got to do an oil change. And I got to do a inspection. He bought it at Meekum. Just like his red 59 Christine looking car. He got rid of that because of the rust in the rockers, and we rode him like a $6,000 or $8,000 estimate, couldn't get half the stuff anyway. So he said, all right, I'll get something a little more readily parts available. You know, these pickup trucks, everything's available, unlike that car he had before. Anyway, we're giving her a love rating of 8. Pretty clean. Old girl. It's a later model steering wheel off something else. I don't know what else this, what this comes off of. It almost looks like a dart wheel or something like that. Maybe one of you guys know. Shows 16,410 on the clock. I'm guessing it's 116, but either way, it's a super nice truck. What does it matter? Could have a million miles on it. It still is what it is when you look at it. So I've begun oil change prep, as you can tell. Pull the dipstick up, get the cap off of there. I'm going to put my funnel in it with a rag on it. Then we're going to lift it up, take a look around. The belts did squeak when I fired it up. Yeah, they're a little, they're pretty loose. So we need to adjust his belts. Ugh. We need to adjust his belts, if not replace them. A lot of times when they run a little loose, they get glazed and all that. No, these actually look okay. All right, we'll just recommend adjusting his belts a little and get a look underneath. Looks pretty nice to me so far. That's not right. This is designed to point into oncoming traffic. See how this one's straight, this one's not. So that's gonna be an issue. We can fix that easy. Joe got the GTO running. There's the old Holly trick. Oh yeah, that's pretty cool. It's out of gas, so the gauge doesn't work. But the carburetor also floods, which I love. That's, I've talked about that before, those Holly carburetors. Mm-mm-mm. If your car sits a lot, those carburetors, you better know how to tinker with them and tap on them. And that's why I use the Edelbrock carburetor on my truck, just because it's less cantankerous. Not as good if you're making 500 or 600 horsepower, but a lot of people think they put headers on their 350, they got 500 horsepower, but it's more like 240. So anyway, let's get this in the air. I like the wheels on it too, by the way, but it needs the center caps. They took the front ones off because of the grease cap. There's got to be a way you can extend that out to clear the grease cap, I would hope. Going up. All right. Ooh, that exhaust looks interesting. Someone's done some work on it. Everything looks pretty good. Not very rusty. Lower control arm bushings are headed for dismay, but for right now, they're okay. We'll just have to tell them to keep an eye on it. Got a little bit of an oil leak. Someone's done a fuel pump and there's a tiny bit of oil coming out of that gasket. Nothing horrible. A little bit of an oil leak from here. Rear main maybe, or valley. This has a valley cup pan under the intake. That sometimes they leak oil as cork. Back then everything was cork. You young guys, you don't understand. You used to have to do gaskets on an engine sometimes at 30,000-40,000 miles over and over and over because the cork would only hold up so long. But someone has done some exhaust work. You can understand that on a vehicle this age. It's got a patent on the muffler made in Mexico. And got quite a few adapters going on and a new piece of pipe where it broke, I'm guessing. But if it's sealed, it's sealed. It actually sounds pretty good when it runs. It sounds pretty quiet. I don't hear exhaust leaks or anything. So let's see here. The parking brake cables are a little sketch. This has a cantilever, pulls on this, this pulls on this, just multiplies the torque a little bit, so it's not as hard to step on the parking brake. Got new shocks. Ooh. Come here. This thing, the magnet is crazy stiff. Might have to pull the rear wheel off here. Get a look at the rear brakes. It's weird, there's two parking brake holes. I guess so the backing plate will work on either side. Cool. It's got a pretty decent sized rear end in it for a little 318. Yeah, any of you guys, Dodge guys, if you know, did they come with 318s in a Warlock? Was it just an appearance package? I don't see anything really to be too worried about. Spare. No dry rod or anything on the spare. Okay, not bad at all. Looks like the it's like a 21 or a 7/8 on the drain plug. Old school, dripping on the pipe canister, regular filter, screw-on filter, I mean. It's actually in pretty good shape. I like it. Got a little rust in here, but nothing, no rot yet. It's just surface rust, and it's a nice truck. It's in better shape than the red car so far. That's good. Nice older guy, worked for Chrysler his whole life, so he loves Chrysler and Dodge, and I do too, before like 1974. I wouldn't mind a nice Dodge Dart with a 340, or a Duster even. Barracudas and Challengers are just too expensive, out of my price range. Let's get this oil change done. All right, old school strap wrench coming in handy right here. Ugh, oh geez, that's not supposed to be that tight. Maybe it's just been on here a while. This is one of those vehicles you're gonna change it based on time, not mileage. It wasn't as bad as I thought it might have gotten to be. Let that run a little bit. This is gonna have a plastic washer on it. It is a 79, by the way. I got some paperwork. That's how I found out what filter it takes. Old school, 1085. Made in China, where all the good stuff comes from. Now. Ah! A little bit of that. Gotta wipe it down a little bit. Exhaust. Okay. Just like I remembered. Old school. I like it. I like the old school. Well, 7/8, that's what I kind of thought, so I wanted to try it second. Because I knew it wasn't right. It's 13/16. It's smaller than that.
Wow, 3/4. Who would have thought? There's no way my eyeballs were right on that one, because normally I think things are bigger than they really are. Oh, wait a second. That makes sense now. Never mind. This is 3/4. Some of you young kids might think of it as 19 millimeter. It's only a few thousandths difference. Let's see if it ends up in the drain like we hope. We'll let it drain like that. So I turned it another turn. Now we got a magical crusade of 4 separate oil drips. Cool. All right, enough silliness. I'm gonna walk away, let this take its course, and come back to it in a minute. Yeah, not for nothing, but the Volkswagen coolant sensor, of course, broke in half coming apart, so I had to spend some extra time on that. Got that in. I left the dongle for my Phoenix light in the OBD2 port. I didn't think it would kill the battery, but it did. So the battery's down charging. And of course, this drain plug thing is adding to the mystery and intrigue, making it more entertaining for everyone, me and you. I hope you're enjoying it as much as I am. I'm gonna try not to get covered in oil. I've already spilled some, because when I turned it another turn, all 4 of the drips were missing the pan, basically. So I picked 2 to cover and let it drip here a little bit. Just starting off the week on fire. that explains it. It's got like a cool expander drain plug. So those slots make the oil go out 4 different directions. Cut off the old gasket with my flush cutters. Got me a sweet aluminum gasket. Should be a little more durable than that plastic. I am going to use the cool 4-slotted drain plug though for the next guy, which will probably be me. And I won't remember. And I'll replicate the situation. It's all part of the fun, man. funny how much smaller it looks with a gasket that's not crushed coming around. Filter's tight. Clean up my mess a little bit. Get this thing on the ground, get some fresh dinosaur blood in her. On our way down, we're gonna take a look at the steering and suspension stuff, just in case. Rag joint looks good. Uh-oh. Centerlink, see that play? It's gonna need a centerlink. Not terrible, but it's got play in it, so I have to at least put it on the list. Everything else looks pretty good though. All right, let's catch you guys up. Things running way better. I adjusted his carburetor. Someone had pushed in the idle mixture screws too far. I backed them out almost a turn to get the idle to smooth out. It's running great now. We put in 5 quarts of dinosaur blood, 1030. He doesn't want a sticker on the window. He came out and helped me, so I couldn't film the whole process for you guys. So I apologize, but we got it fixed up good. It's in nice shape. Tires are dry rotted. Centerlink's got some play, I showed you that. So I'm gonna give him an estimate for a couple things, see what happens with it. And go on to the next one. Wonder what that means. Turn steering wheel. That's cool. What is going on with this thing? Oh my goodness gracious. Turn steering wheel. Let's try out of the vehicle with the keys. Steering wheel warning light is blinking. That could have something to do with the battery going dead. Let's plug this in again. Charger's still on. It's been charging for 2 hours. We will hook things up and see what's going on. Won't let it crank. Apparently it's mad about the steering wheel. Won't let the ignition turn on all of a sudden either. All right, let me go look at the battery level, see what's going on with that. Software updates are done. What is this thing doing? It won't even turn the ignition on now. It's saying steering column lock defective. All right. Steering column lock defective. It's mad about something. It won't turn the ignition on or anything. I'm going to disconnect the battery, reconnect it, possibly set the car on fire, and we'll come back. All right, the battery's at 13 volts, so I took the terminals off, jumped the two terminals together with my loop. This is same color wire. It connects inside here. We'll let it sit a few minutes. It's saying steering column lock defective. It won't even turn the ignition on to let me talk to the scanner. I don't know what happened from Friday to today. I put a coolant temp sensor in it from the other engine that came out. I don't know. This car's cursed or something, I guess, or I am, or maybe both. I don't know. I'm trying to get it to talk to whatever modules I can. It won't light up the screen at all. It won't even attempt to start. If I try to start it, it says steering column lock defective, even after jumping out the battery for a second. When I hooked the negative up, I got a big. So I'm not sure why it's mad. We're gonna have to try to figure it out, I guess. And we got a whole bunch of codes. So it says engine electronics not equipped, because I guess the ignition is not really on. So it's talking to the modules it can. I'm gonna try clearing out the codes from the modules I'm able to, and we'll see what happens. I gotta keep my dongle lit up, so I keep going back and forth, making sure the blue light's blinking, and then it'll talk to more modules, and it's not even lighting up the check engine light stuff and all that it was before. Even this morning it had it lit up. We'll get it figured out. We're just gonna have to do some major dancing. This car is eating my lunch, so not sure what I can do differently. Like the S10, I took a quick look at that. It looks like it's got a bad battery cable. The positive battery cable is looking sketch. So I told them we could repair it or replace it. And they got me some universal cable.
So it probably also has a bad battery because the battery was at 11.8 volts this morning. I turned the key on, it drops to 8 volts. But it's just been sitting over the weekend. You guys saw the amp draw test. It had zero amp draw. So maybe we'll try that again on the S10. We'll try to get one of these cars out of here this week. Be nice to get them both out of here. But we're almost done to where we can try clearing codes and see if this thing will start. All I did this morning is put a coolant temp sensor in it, put the wheel liners and the tires on it, and that's the only thing I've done to it today. So that's the problem when you buy a car that doesn't run too. You have no idea what you're getting into. Way better off spending a little more money for something that runs and drives, you know, especially if you're going to try to scam the insurance company. It's no better than the insurance company scamming you, right? Someone's got to be the bigger person in this world. And I guess it's expensive to do the right thing. I know it cost me a fortune. I tried to get my taxes done at the accountant Saturday. And they won't do them until I do my YouTube corporate taxes. Because, you know, my YouTube is LLC now. Because my income put me just into the next tax bracket where I pay 22% taxes. Because I'm rich. Come on, man. I got 4% left to go. All right, I got past that into where I could push clear DTCs, and I lost my communication again. I think it times out is what happens after about 30 seconds or a minute. It times out. Got my light again. Trying to clear these DTCs, see what we can do about this issue. Access start authorization. I could try to look at codes and all, but I'm pretty frustrated right now. I'm going to try to clear them and see what happens. Steering column lock defective. That's after the ABS one. Steering column electronics, 2 codes. All right, we'll be back. All right, we got wiring printouts and relay location printouts, and there's something going on with the power relay intermittently not lighting this thing up. Rob put a battery in it for me while I was at lunch just to try it, but it didn't make a difference. We're gonna take a break on this car because I'm getting stressed out, and we're going to do an alignment on a 22-year-old rusty Nissan Rogue from up north. we're going to try. We're going to shake down the front end and see what that looks like. It's got 117,000 original miles. It's pretty clean, but man, is it rusty underneath. Let me grab a light. We'll go take a look. Look at this thing, huh? Good luck getting that. I don't know why they came in for an alignment. They didn't say if it had a vibration or if there was a complaint. They just said a wheel alignment pays 1 hour. So I'm gonna shake the front end down, and I don't know what's going on lately, but there's something in the mojo is not mojoing. So we're gonna go ahead and make sure this thing doesn't need front end work and things like that. We'll deal with the rust if the front end looks okay. Now that one's pretty good. This one, get it in. Some lighting for you so you can see it. That is no good. So lower ball joint, part of the A arm I think on this, and I'm probably gonna go with inner and outer tie rod ends because of the rust. Because of that rust, I'm assuming it's not gonna be adjustable. So let me write up an estimate on this thing. We'll talk to the customer about it. We'll see if they want to do anything more. Oh my, I gotta do a water pump on the Jaguar out there too. I don't know if you can see it, it's a little glary. It's got a leaking water pump. Rob looked at it and they pre-sold it. That'd be my next one.
But it wasn't about you.
Give me a 5 and a love rating, by the way. I don't know if I mentioned that. We're gonna do the ball joint and free up the tie rod ends on a regular lift so we can bring it back in the alignment rack and hopefully adjust them. They don't wanna replace them. They said, if you can't do it without replacing them, then don't worry about the alignment. Okay, let's do it. Gravity check! Oh, trust me, there's plenty of gravity around here. Things are getting heavy. They want to try to get these loose, so we're going to try to get these loose. That's all I can say. They'll probably turn off of this, but turning it on the rusty threads, that's the problem. Told you it would come right off. Now you know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna get a wire wheel
and wire wheel those threads a little bit, see if we can help it some more. And wear a face shield if you're gonna, if your face has to be in line with these wire wheels, always wear a face shield. Because they will fly out of there and poke you. The old Milwaukee doesn't like working with the wire wheel because more load equals shut off. And I'm barely pressing. Just enough, a little more magic juice. Deep creep. I'm gonna let that soak a little bit. Go start loosening the other side up the same way. And we'll do that ball joint while it soaks.
I think I got these freed up a little bit. I spun it out about two turns, sprayed some deep creep on the inside and the outside. I held this with my, some of you guys might not have seen this cool tool. That there is a, that's a bad Johnny, Muller Kepps. If this doesn't turn it, it'll snap it. So the only problem I have with it, it only opens to a certain size. So it's useless if it's just a little too big, you can't use it. But it'll grab onto this, these hexes, which you normally would use like a 12 or 13 on. And it will, it takes a little bit of finagling. Once that thing bites, it's not going anywhere. And it will break a tie rod end, which I'm not saying I've ever done it, I'm just saying I've heard. So we're gonna do the ball joint while this soaks. But I think by the time we get to the alignment rack, since I've got the nuts to turn on the inner tie rods on both sides, I think it'll be okay. This is held in with a pinch bolt. I think it's a 18 or a 19. Let's see, it's 18. So since I brought 17 and 19, because the new replacement bolt is 17 and 19, the original one is 18 and 18. So I gotta get more tools. That's to be expected in this line of work. Jeez. Louise, I don't know how you guys up north do it. I'm just saying, I don't wanna beat a dead horse, but if I have to, I'll kick him and roll him around and drag him around the parking lot. I'm just saying. Well, now she's kind of mushroomed, so I'm gonna use an air hammer. So eyes and ears, people. That's what I'm saying. I tried to set you on my cart and it didn't work. You fell. I apologize. I'm gonna use a cutoff wheel and cut off the mushroom tip. You know what I'm saying? Louise, you know what I'm saying? Geez Louise, that's how it goes. That's a little better. I think that'll go. Once we give it a little love from the love mallet. Be gone, demon. All right, I'll spare you the time I wasted trying to get my little strut knuckle spreader tool. This is too tight of a gap, doesn't fit, so. I'll spare you that wasted time.
So we're not all wasting our time, just me.
Trying not to wail on it too hard. I gotta reuse this arm.
The ball joint stud basically doesn't want to come out of the knuckle.
So
might get ugly. See what I mean? Don't worry, I didn't have my face in front of it. The last thing anybody wants is for me to get uglier.
Something happened. Oh yeah. Something happened now, alright. Cooperation or else.
I'm gonna win this battle one way or another. I got a YouTube channel to run. See what Mr. Mac Prybar has to say about the whole ordeal. Interesting to get it off the ball joint. We'll see. We will see.
Sometimes you just need more prying devices and you're home free. That's what I needed in this case.
It's another simple auto mechanics rule. He who has the most prying force wins.
So now we will get some kind of apparatus to press that out.
Well, it might be hard to see because of my poor studio lighting. But I worked a screwdriver around here instead of trying to use a snap ring tool with all that rust and everything. I just worked my screwdriver around and forced the snap ring off. It's nasty. Now it seems like a job for the BJP one.
I want to see in there a little bit better though.
Get a little shop air action going. Oh yeah, that ought to pop right out of there, I'm thinking. Ugh. I should have waited. I can't believe I still do that.
Uh-oh,
stay with me now.
There you go.
Oh, you're still moving, okay. Using my BJP1 from Mr. Snappy, and we might have to get a little ugly here and force this thing. I got my block of wood holding this, but it might not be enough. Rah! There you go. I apologize if it's hard to see. I'll move you in a second. Hang out. This is a good tool. Like everything Snap-on, very expensive, but the Matco one is really nice too and cost even more. I think this thing, when I got it, was like $750 on sale. Now it's like, people are telling me $950, $1,000. I'll have to do some ball joints. The tool's probably worth about $300, $350. But typical Snap-on fashion, they go, what's that worth? And they triple it. Then they tell you how great the warranty is. But that's a topic for another video, I suppose. You guys have been watching my channel for a while. You know how I feel. They make some good stuff, but a lot of it is so overpriced that they really test your loyalty. And some people comment on my toolbox videos as if I don't have any idea what I'm talking about. And I've owned 7 Snap-on toolboxes, so. Anyway, this cup is outside the ball joint housing. This one's gonna push on the ball joint housing. So they should come apart, right? Careful that piece of wood don't hit you in the face.
Yeah. All right.
Now for the new one, I want to push this in and have a cup that goes around the outside of the top. So I got to change my adapters. This is the best thing about this Snap-on press. Mess with the adapters all you want.
Even if your camera holder that couldn't recommend it isn't that great and it flops around a little too much. I think he works it. He recommended this thing that I'm using to hold my camera, and I've been using it a couple days, and so far I'm not very impressed. The magnet's a little too strong, and the squishy adjustable part's too soft. It lets the camera move. I'm guessing he probably doesn't have some of the things on his camera I do, because he sets up a little more of a studio thing where I'm at work and I'm just moving the camera around really quick, trying to get you guys some footage. But we're gonna keep rocking it and trying, because when I was editing last week's videos, I was like, man, that's a cool shot I couldn't get before. So we'll do what we have to do. Let's get the correct pieces for this. I think I could put this on top. No problemo with that. And the bottom, have to get a different cup. This is what the kit looks like if you haven't seen it. Now, I want to push on this. Oh, it's pretty close. It's gonna rip up this inner corner. I don't want to do that if I can avoid it. Yeah, it doesn't quite fit. This is an extension. It's not gonna work either. And the next one's too big. What do you guys think? I can't use that either because it's too deep. I need something that's gonna push on this edge but not go past it, because this is flush with the bottom of the arm. This one here has an angle to it. It's made for some of the Fords and stuff that go in crooked. You know, Ford likes to do things unique. Look at that, it would fit perfectly if it was flat. Maybe I should take it over the grinder and make it flat, then buy another one that's not flat. Oh, Snap-on man don't come in anymore. The new Snap-on guy came in once. We didn't buy enough stuff, so he stopped coming in. And I say we, meaning Joe, because no one else goes on the Snap-on truck here. Anyway, I am in quite a conundrum here. You don't want to push on the silver part. You want to push on the black outer ring. And I'm going to have to see what I come up with here, and we'll come back. The 8A cup ends up fitting pretty well. I don't know how I missed that one the first couple go rounds, but it is what it is. I found it, so I get it as far together as I can by hand. Finish it off with the impact gun, which a lot of these tools say, do not use an impact. This doesn't say that. Everyone uses an impact anyway. You just gotta be careful, because you're going to do some damage on the suspension arm or your tool if things aren't lined up right. So I always kind of try to be patient, get that in there pretty good. You got to watch right here for when it's flush with the arm. That's it. You hear it change sound? Done deal. Now I gotta put the snap ring on, start putting this thing back together. Some of you guys might know, these snap rings are stamped. So there's a sharp side and a rounded side. I try to put the sharp side facing up. I just feel like it'll bite a little better and won't be as inclined to come apart. I'm using a Lang snap ring set I got off JD Tico, and no fault of his, but one of them was defective out of the box. The threads were messed up. But I fixed them, tapped them and stuff. That's just a little bit of insurance, that little snap ring. I've never seen one where it moved and the snap ring was the only thing holding it in. I've seen them where there was no snap ring on it and it didn't come apart. But I don't recommend that. Now, let's see if we can get this back together. Well, I shouldn't say that. I know it's going back together. Just wondering how much fun it's going to be. This is going to go forward. Let's see if that works. There you go. Problem.
care, show it a little love. Don't get crazy. You don't want to deform the ball joint. Now I'm looking through here for when I'll be able to get my bolt in. When I'll be able to get the bolt in through here. I was gonna try to align this tonight, but I guess he's got something to do.
I didn't think it was fucking good. Awesome.
Something gonna get easy for me this month?
I was like, you know, Jimmy, it's not over yet though, so don't.
How about we just take a break from that hoopsie for a little bit?
Don't get too excited.
Let me get you back to feeling better about yourself.
It's not over yet. Don't get too excited. We got BMW SUVs on the hook. We got Jaguars. We got Volkswagens. Not an American car to be had. Oh, 68 GTO. That's different. That's American. Oh, my goodness gracious.
What?
None of these nuts will go on. You hold your lip right. There you go.
So, oh, yep.
So brand new parts. Is he doing alignment on that?
He's checking the suspension parts and stuff. The guy wants to see how everything feels in front. Make sure they're tight.
Looks like the car was all distorted. I did find a body mount bushing floating around the frame rail on the right side. And a loose bolt in the right rear frame mount. I stuck my fingers in there where the rubber was to make sure the rubber was on and the bolt went chicka chicka chicka.
Move
that undertrasser jack while I get off the spot. Oh, hell yeah. Hope doesn't have a bad tire. They don't look like it. Oh. Camera turned itself on about 4 minutes ago. Started recording on its own. All right, let's grab these keys, lock this thing down. We're not hanging on the alignment rack tonight. Got the big old bird, so line it tomorrow. That's all right. Thanks for watching today's video. I hope it wasn't torture for you like it was for me. Better days are ahead. Just keep on rowing. Eventually, you're going to get past it and move on. Gobstoppers will be behind you, a distant memory, and you can start on a new gobstopper, like the BMW, the Range Rover, and the Dodge Journey they towed in on flatbeds today. Torque the like button before you leave if you would. I really appreciate that. And subscribe if you're new here and you haven't subscribed yet. And you like seeing a real mechanic, trials and tribulations, spending a day in your shop. Hope I see you the next one. You're awesome.